Hi, welcome to the Property Show. I'm Jayashree Kurup. I'm editor MBTV, and we have with us T.K. Arun. He's the consulting editor of the Economic Times. Difficult times need creative solutions, and Arun has been propagating the idea of a good, healthy, robust bonds market in India, which could be the only solution to that large volume of long-term capital that the real estate market needs. So, Arun, thank you for joining us. You know, there are all kinds of viewers listening to this show. So let's start with the basics. What is a bonds market and why does the real estate market need one?
Yeah. So let's understand, first of all, what is capital, right? We know that broadly any project, any investment calls for capital. Now, what precisely is capital? Now, any money that is used to generate a fresh stream of income is capital. If you use money to buy a big fat tub of ice cream, that's not capital, it's consumed. But if you buy a house, it can generate income in the future. If you are self-occupied, you're not paying rent, so you're creating an implicit income flow. If you put it on rent, you will get rental income. If you buy equity, you will get dividend or capital gains. If you buy bonds, you will get interest payment. So, and capital, again, there are two kinds. One is equity and the other is debt, broadly speaking. So, in the case of equity, this is an instrument that gives you a certain fractional ownership for the entity which has issued that equity. But it also entails risk. The equity of a company will not be serviced, that is, will not be provided with profits unless there are profits. If there are profits, yes, you get your dividends, you get capital appreciation. If the company is sold for a fabulous price, then you'll get a beneficiary of that. However, the downside is that if the entity does not make profits, you'll get nothing. If it goes bankrupt, it will be wiped out. So this is risk capital. Now, debt capital is supposed to be relatively less risky because debt has to be serviced regardless of whether the enterprise makes profits or not. Right. Now, this is broadly the idea of capital and debt and equity capital. Yeah. Now, debt can be provided in two ways. One is you go to a bank and you take a loan and then it's a tenure, you get a rate of interest and then you get it. The second way is that you can issue bonds. Now, suppose you want to raise 100 crore. You are a small, relatively small property developer, and you have a good track record of completing the projects that you promised to build. And you are more or less sure that you will actually find takers for your bonds. So what does it mean? You issue bonds and saying the bond is a number of securities whose aggregate value is the amount that you want to raise. Instead of raising 100 crore as one loan from one bank or multiple banks as a consortium, you issue bonds. Suppose each bond is, let's say, 1,000 rupees. So in 1 lakh, you will get 100 bonds, right? 10 lakh, 1,000 bonds. 1 crore, 100,000 bonds. Like that, you issue so many bonds. Now, so since there are multiple bonds, one single entity doesn't have to purchase all these bonds. On this bond, you promise to service the bond. That is, you will provide a coupon, which means you will provide a certain rate of interest on a particular day. And you will repay the amount at the end of that tenure. It could be for 5 years, could be for 10 years, could be for 15 years. There are some countries and some companies which have managed to issue bonds for 100 years. And there are some perpetual bonds. There is no particular time period when the bond will be redeemed. You constantly keep on paying interest on that bond. Now, bonds are liquid. Most bonds can be traded. So if you can trade the bond, the investor, while in possession of the bond, gets the interest, the coupon due on the bond, plus whatever other benefits can accrue from the bond. But suppose the investor needs liquidity, he is able to go to the bond market, sell it, and it is money. So bonds are a convenient way of raising money, capital. Now,
why did the developers go to banks and not raise bonds till now in the Indian market?
Because we don't have an actual bond market. We have a bond market that is mostly for government debt. We have a very primitive market for corporate debt. Now, it is growing. To the on the good news is that the corporate bond market is slowly matured. A lot of things have to change for a market to really grow. See, if you issue a bond, and for the investor who purchased that bond, there are multiple risks. Now, the basic risk is that by the time the bond is ready to be redeemed, you have to get your principal back. This company might be in trouble and might not be able to repay them. So there is a credit risk, right? Plus, there is an interest rate risk. You are investing at a time when you think that the rate of interest offered by the bond is pretty decent compared to other opportunities in the market. But suppose the rate of interest goes up. Again, for the borrower, suppose the rate of interest goes down.
Yeah.
But he is committed to paying this particular rate of interest. So there is an interest rate risk against which you need to hedge. Plus, while we don't realize it, there is a currency risk. You are issuing a rupee bond in the sense that you are asking people to give you money in rupees. But in that process, you are foregoing a dollar bond. You might as well issue a bond in dollars and somebody might have come and invested in the dollar bond. Now, in our limited experience, we have certainly seen the rupee depreciate in value against the dollar.
Right.
So we might think that it's only crazy people will actually think of issuing an interest. But suppose you're issuing a 20-year bond. And suppose the Indian economy is reasonably well managed, that we contain inflation below a particular level, say 4%. And that productivity increases in India are much higher and faster than productivity increases in the US and other major currencies, which is entirely possible because we are operating at a very low level productivity. So when our productivity level goes up, then our exchange rate can appreciate. So that is one of the dependencies of exchange rate. One is, of course, the interest rate differential. The other is the inflation rate differential. And the third is the productivity rate differential. If these things go in our favor, the rupee can actually appreciate vis-a-vis the dollar. So by foregoing a dollar bond issue, you are sort of assumed that you will not actually be able to, the rupee will not appreciate, you might actually bear a loss. So there is an implicit risk you assume by not issuing the dollar bond. Now, typically, both the issuer of the bond and the buyer of the bond should be able to hedge against all these risks.
Mm-hmm.
If they can hedge against these risks, of course, there's a cost to hedging, but the cost might not be, if there's an efficient market, the cost will not be very high. So if incorporating all these risks, all these costs of hedging against these risks, the bond is still worthwhile, then people will invest in bonds or they will issue bonds. Now, for these to happen, you need to be able to hedge against the risk.
Yeah.
And how do you hedge against the risk? You have forward markets, your futures market, and you have what I call derivative market, options to buy something at a particular price or to sell something at a particular price. These are called derivative instruments. The call options are the option of buying, and the put options are the option of selling at a particular price at a particular point of time. Now, you need functional derivative markets on against these different kinds of risks. If you can buy a dollar at a particular price at a particular time in the future, 1 year from now, 2 years from now, 3 years from now, and then you are sort of hedged against the risk, right? Now, you don't need to buy that forward dollar. You can buy an option on that. And if you need to, you can buy it. Now, all these fine array of finely diced and sliced derivatives must be available for you to comfortably invest in the bond market. Now, in India, we haven't had these kind of derivative instruments. Similarly, there is something called credit default swaps. So these swaps are what allow you to insure against credit risk, that somebody will not repay a loan, or will not be able to repay the principal amount or a bond. Mm-hmm. Now, again, it's like a small insurance premium that you pay. Depending upon the credibility of the issuer and depending upon the condition of the business cycle in which he is issuing, or it can vary over time, the value of this credit default swap will change. So here again, there is money to be made just by buying and selling these derivative instruments. You can have a view that your credit default swap will actually lose in value. So you can short sell them, or you can have a view that these are actually going to go up. And so there are various ways of making money from this derivative instruments that basically serve the purpose of hedging against risk. Now, the global financial crisis happened when a whole lot of these kind of bond issuances, derivatives based on the underlying bonds, were issued in a manner that created additional risk. Instead of mitigating risk, these instruments are purely serving the purpose of being allowed to hedge against risk. They created additional risk. So these are risky instruments unless they are well regulated. So you not only need a whole array of derivative instruments to hedge against possible many kinds of risk, you also need to regulate. There are ways of asking people to margin these things properly and making sure that these are sold and traded on an exchange. Credit default swaps, for example, were over the counter. I mean, you don't have to list them on an exchange. You need to trade them on an exchange. It could be directly between somebody who offers his insurance and somebody who needs that insurance. Now, after the global financial crisis, the regulation of finance improved substantially, at least conceptually. So many markets have adopted far better norms to ensure that things are less risky. But this has been the history of finance. The first time something like a market, we now take the markets regulator SEBI for granted, right? Now SEBI follows the model set by the American Securities and Exchange Commission, SEC. The SEC came to be after the market crash of 1929, which then was followed by the Great Depression that all of us have heard about. So drawing from the lessons of what led to the market collapse in 1929, the US government and Congress set up the Securities and Exchange Commission.
Yeah.
So you learn some institutional wisdom. After the Enron collapse, they created this Dodd-Frank Act. I mean, the various things were sort of improve corporate governance. Sorry, Dodd-Frank, also after the global financial crisis, not after the Enron thing. So you learn many lessons from each crisis, and then you put in place institutional mechanisms to bring in better regulation, better transparency, and better pricing. Now, in the global financial crisis, many people were buying into fancy derivative instruments, which they basically did not understand. They just went by the rating provided to them by a rating agency, and by the fact that your competitor or the fellow pension fund manager was actually buying into these instruments. So you bought them, it is safe. But then they were not safe. So the underlying at the base of it was mortgages made to people who had no hope in hell of servicing those mortgages. Now, I don't know if you have watched that movie on the global financial crisis, where the guy who makes a lot of money does so because he went to the trouble of going into every single mortgage, and he realized all these borrowers are people who just could not service their loans. So he knew some sooner or later they will all collapse. And he took financial positions on the market, anticipating their collapse, and he made millions and millions of dollars.
Yes.
Now, just to...
why is the Indian market bonds market so nascent? Do you see us moving towards a bond market at all?
Yes, I think so. The crisis is making us make the change. See, typically, infrastructure projects, they require a long period to construct. They require a lot of capital, and that capital will be fully paid back, and you will get the returns that justify the investment only after a long period of time. So 15 to 20 years time, you'll require to fully justify and get returns from a road project or a port project or a large power plant.
Yeah.
Now, these are not projects that require a lot of equity, because there isn't much risk. If there is demand for a particular service, say of a port or a power plant, the electricity, then the risk element is not very high. So you don't need much risk capital. That is, you don't need equity capital. You basically need debt capital, right? In India, in olden times, we used to have what are called the development financial institutions, DFIs. The ICICI used to be a development financial institution. IDBI used to be a development financial institution. Now many of them converted into banks. They no longer give loans for 15, 20, 30 years.
Yeah.
Banks take deposits from people like you and me, small savers. These deposits have to be paid back to the depositor, right? At short notice. You might have a term deposit of 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 5 years, 7 years. Very few people have longer horizons than that. But infrastructure projects require money for much longer periods. So if you are going to a bank for raising debt for an infrastructure project, you are essentially asking the bank to make you loans where the maturity of the deposit, that is the primary source from which they get the money, is much shorter for the bank as compared to the asset they are financing, that the road or port project or power plant that you are trying to finance or a real estate construction project. So there is the asset they are creating, that is this road, and the liability that banks have, which is the depositors. There is a mismatch in their time profile or their maturity. So this asset liability mismatch is a huge issue. So banks typically are not in a position to give money for a long period of time. So this is a problem from the supply side of capital. Then there is a mismatch in the demand side of capital. Look at a life insurance company. You collect premium for many years, and typically, unless there is an unfortunate accident, in which case you need to pay them upfront, you require to make the payment after a fairly long period of time, 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. Now, ideally, you would like to invest in an asset which has that kind of a maturity, because then you have very little risk. You have some forward visibility on what is the income stream that will come from this particular asset that you are buying. So typically insurance companies, pension funds, again, pensions are to be paid after retirement. So after a fairly long period of time. So pension funds and retirement funds and insurance companies, life insurance companies, they typically require assets which have a long maturity. Now in India, you have neither long maturity assets to invest in, nor long maturity bonds that people can raise. So after banks started lending massively to infrastructure projects in the aftermath of the global financial crisis, the government also wanted lending to be free in order to ensure that the economy didn't go into a tailspin, into a recession. So liberal credit was fairly liberal. Lots of people raised money. Perhaps some of that money was not properly utilized. Projects were over-invoiced. Instead of 4 crore per megawatt of power generation capacity, people put a bill of 6 crore per megawatt, 50% over-invoicing. And they took the money out and they put it into various overseas accounts or whatever they did. So the inflated project costs created more expensive assets, infrastructure assets. The expensive assets will in turn produce expensive power. If it gets a power plant, the power that you sell from that power plant will be more expensive than the power produced from a power plant whose capital cost is 4 crore per megawatt, right? So all these kind of problems arise. Now banks gave these loans, and because many of these infrastructure projects ran into trouble, some because of inherent problems of the project being unviable, some because extraneous factors chipped in. some state governments that had signed power purchase agreements refused to buy the power. And there's no recourse. If the state doesn't pay, then what do you do? You can go to court and wait for the next 100 years and you might not get the court case resolved. Yeah. So many of these projects, and then land acquisition problems came in. You are building a road. You have built a 50 kilometer stretch from one side and a 10 kilometer stretch from the other side. But in between, there is a 10 kilometer stretch for which land is not available. They are holding up. And you couldn't get environmental clearance. All kinds of problems happen. And the project gets delayed, but the clock is ticking on the bank loan. You have to keep servicing that bank loan after a period of time. And they could not service it, and the project became a non-performing asset. So bank loans are not a very good way of financing long-term infrastructure projects, long gestation projects. So having accumulated non-performing assets of various kinds, banks would be reluctant to fund infrastructure projects in the future, right? So there is a need for alternative of funding. So from your experience with the real estate projects, you know that real estate projects went to NBFCs, not bank.
One minute. I want you to, like you spoke about infrastructure, I want you to address the real estate sector also. Here also there is need for long-term capital to buy land. If you buy, say, 30 acres of land or 100 acres of land, you're not going to convert all of that into real estate assets immediately.
Right.
So for which you need money to purchase the land, you need money to build in phases and projects. Even if you build fast, in India, the typical life cycle of any one phase of a project is 4 to 5 years. So, which means that they do need long-term capital, and they need, the cost of capital is so high that the projects become non-viable. There are several problems. First is that the delayed approvals raise the cost, right? They raise the period. There is no formal capital available to purchase land. So they have to use their own internal resources, which is what a lot of the buyer money has gone into, to buy more land. And the third thing is that the project needs 4-year cycle, but the bank lending is much lower, or a smaller tenure, or it's very expensive, right? So address the real estate issue also before you go into the bonds.
Yeah. So real estate has some additional problems in the sense that the market is fundamentally flawed. Now things have stabilized, but otherwise, a real estate developer's real moolah came from appreciation of land. It used to be taken for granted that if you bought land at price X, you hold it on for 10 years, it will become 10X. So this appreciation in the price of land was deemed to be the biggest price in the real estate market. And why is there such appreciation? Because in India, by policy, we create an artificial scarcity of urban land. Now, urban land is a man-made thing. It is not a naturally provided thing. You can convert rural land, farmland into urban land and increase supply of urban land with some proper planning. You can build roads, trams, trains, metros, good expressways, and ensure that you have fast connectivity from point A to point B, and make sure that point A also becomes part of point the city, which is in point B. So today, you have the ability to run trains at 180 kilometers in India. Japan, Shinkoku, the bullet trains, they can run at 300 kilometers. In France, the TGV runs at 500 kilometers. So, which means that commuters can stay within the traveling distance of the place. So, your supply of urban land can be expanded by first converting rural land into urban land and by providing good connectivity. Now, in India, we don't allow urban land supply to go up dramatically. So there are too many Western trends in keeping this supply constrained. You know, in converting farmland into urban land, there's a huge premium. And to secure that premium, you need the intermediary of politically well-connected people. There are brokers who make money. There are government officials who make money on this conversion, etc. Suppose you didn't have all this. Suppose urban land was there for the asking. Then the real profits in real estate would come from your ability to utilize the capital in acquiring the land, in making that construction, adding the value, just like in, you know, you buy a plastic raw material, convert into a pipe and sell the pipe. So you have added value and you have made your money, profit on that. Real estate will also become like that. Now,
this is a case in point. Hyderabad is the only city which consistently created ring roads, outer ring roads, peripheral ring roads, still outer ring roads, connected the various ring roads. As a result, Hyderabad is the cheapest city in the country and the most actively traded. And when we did a study in Magic Bricks, we found that 55% of consumers in Hyderabad said that we are willing to buy under construction property, which means that if you increase that, exactly what you said, you increase the supply of land, it's a radial city, then there is more land, there is more development, and there is more delivery, and people have more trust.
Yeah. So, because of this basic problem in the land market, added to which is the unreliability of land title, right? You might think that you have bought a parcel of land, but then once you start building or making applications, somebody else comes and says, this is actually my land. That the person who sold it to you committed a fraud. Now that fellow might be a fraudster. We don't know. So unless there is certainty of title, land-based activity becomes slightly tricky. So given the value of land tending to change dramatically depending upon the supply situation, apart from business cycles, and given the unreliability of titles, you have deemed real estate development to be a very risky activity.
Yeah.
So the risk weight that RBI asks banks to assign to a loan to a real estate project is relatively high, which makes the banks hesitate when it comes to making loans, and they add a risk premium, which adds to the cost of doing that money. Now, which is, you know, kind of ridiculous. If you look at it from a macro point of view, no economy in the world has prospered without urbanization.
Yeah.
Because modern jobs, whether in industry or services, are created in urban cities. You can't create them on the farm, right? Some few services can come up on the farm, but most services will come up in the cities. And when the new jobs are created in the towns, people will move from village to town to take up those jobs. This is how basically urbanization happens.
Yeah.
China is now nearly 60% urban. India is 32% urban according to 2011 census. If India follows the trajectory of countries that have become prosperous in the past, we will also become urban in larger and larger proportions. So India were to become 50% urban, that is 18% additional of the population shifts from village to town. We will require anything between 20,000 to 25,000 square kilometers of urban space to be built up.
Yeah.
Now, this calls for planning. This calls for policy. How do you release land on the scale from rural to, people cannot crowd into the existing towns, right? It means some 25 crore people additionally moving from village to town. Where will they come? They cannot really crowd into existing towns. You need to build new towns. So you need to have a policy of zoning where you say in this area, you can create a township. Now, and urbanization seen this way, of course, is a very desirable thing, right? But urbanization ultimately means built up space, which is real estate. So what is an essential driving force of prosperity in your economy, the basic infrastructure of prosperity in the economy, is seen as a high risk activity to which if you provide capital, you have to have a high risk weight in your, and I'll provide additional capital, making the whole thing very tricky for banks to do.
So how will banks address it differently?
So, we have to improve on every front. Land titling has to change. You know, in Australia, in the 19th century, one guy proposed a system of land registration called the torrent system, which is that you have a central registry and there are no titles. You enter the name of a particular person against a particular parcel of land. Now, today, this land can be properly mapped using drones. You can have geographical coordinates being properly, outlined, delineated using GPS and whatever. And say, this parcel of land belongs to person X. When that person X sells it to person Y, it will be registered in the person Y's name in that registry. In that registry, the name will change. And the state will guarantee that whosoever name figures in the registry is the actual owner of that land. Then there's no scope for any dispute, anybody, somebody else. So you have to change your land titling system. Yeah. Give it complete. Secondly, you have to have a policy that will remove this constraint on the availability of urban land. Conversion of rural land in the delineated zones for urbanization should be automatic. And there's no reason for somebody like a Robert Vadra to come in to ensure that this conversion takes place. There should be no need for asking for the mercy of a bureaucrat to allow this conversion. It should be the automatic right of the farmer or the person who buys it from the farmer to convert it. Naturally, a farmer would like to sell it after conversion because the price would be higher. If this happened, then land would become more stable. It would be cease to be a source of wildly changing capital gains. And the profits from real estate would come from construction and the kind of buildings that you get. Then it will become less risky. But with, given the situation itself, the street loans are being made, right?
Yeah.
Now, after banks stop making loans, construction companies turn to non-banking finance companies.
Right.
But which are constrained to give loans only for 2-3 years. They don't have the capacity to lend for many longer periods. And these NBFCs were in turn raising capital, again, short-term capital, by borrowing from mutual funds or borrowing from banks themselves.
Yeah.
Now, if there is a problem in the supply of capital, then the NBFCs are unable to mobilize capital and then they are unable to give money to real estate companies, and the whole cycle breaks down and the real estate companies find themselves without access to capital. Now, if there is a functional bond market, either the NBFCs will be able to issue long-term bonds and raise money and give long-term capital to housing estate companies. There is a National Housing Bank and there are other housing finance companies. They will be able to issue long-term bonds and they will be able to give money to these real estate companies. So whichever way, whether it is a real estate developer of reputation directly raising money from the market by issuing bonds or an intermediary like a housing finance bank or a specialized non-banking finance company issuing the bonds, you basically need a bonds market to issue long-term bonds, which long-term investors like pension funds, insurance companies will buy, and that capital will come into the pool of available resources with the housing finance company or specialized NBFC, who in turn they will give the money to real estate developers. This is what should happen.
What is the implication for an investor? The retail investors, how do they participate in bonds?
So retail investors typically don't have the capacity to hedge against all the different kinds of risks.
Yeah.
They will just buy into a bond fund.
Right.
So bond fund will have the investments capital from a whole lot of retail investors, mm-hmm. and they will employ fairly competent people in fund management who can look at yield curves, you can look at the risks, you can, take positions on multiple derivatives markets and hedge against various kinds of risks. That is the only route that retail investors can have. If you want to directly enter the bond market, you can enter the government bond market and buy some bonds and keep it. Because at least the capital is safe, the government will repay. But if there are interest rate changes, you are not hedging against interest rate changes. A bond fund is a way that retail investors can take part.
You have seen, there are people who asked us about, when we talked about the bonds market, they said, we have bought infrastructure bonds in the past, right? And ICICI, IDBI, infrastructure bonds. Will you see real estate bonds coming like this from any entity?
You see, these infrastructure bonds are actually an interim measure.
Yes.
In the absence of a properly functioning bond market,
mm-hmm.
because these lending institutions needed the capital, they were allowed to issue infrastructure bonds and they were incentivized by offering them tax breaks and so on and so forth that people would invest. But that is not the long-term sustainable solution. In a developed market like the US, the bond market is several times the size of the equity market.
Right.
Municipal bonds are a big issue. State governments issue bonds. Municipalities issue bonds. Of course, if a municipality were to issue bonds, it should have fiscal capacity to service the loan, right? And what Indian municipalities don't really have the fiscal capacity, or they don't exercise that capacity.
We have 2-3 municipalities which have issued bonds. Surat has, Ahmedabad has, I think there was one other municipality. And municipal bonds, you know, in cities, Indore did. So there are well-managed cities which have a fiscal jurisprudence. They seem to be able to raise municipal bonds.
So they do. See, but ultimately, municipal bonds will be serviceable if the municipalities raise enough property tax.
Right.
In India, I mean, all over the world, municipalities are not very good at raising property tax.
Yeah.
Because it's not a very popular measure with the property owners.
Yeah.
So if you are a mayor of a city and standing for re-election, if you promise them, I'll raise your property tax by 5%, you're not going to worry about elected, right? But this is the only way you can actually have sustainable cities, which are essential for a sustainable real estate market. So, and of course, some of the fiscal capacity must be shared by state and central governments with this third tier of government, that is the local government, whether it's the district administration or the city municipality. So altogether, the bond market needs to be several times the size of the equity market. Whereas in India, the bond market is a fraction of the equity market.
Where are we in this entire curve? Where are we? I mean, right now it's just a fraction. What gives you the confidence to say that you see small policy incentives which seem to be indicating that we're moving towards a bond?
So incrementally, the RBI and SEBI have been working towards creating the various prerequisites for a functional equities and bond market.
Yeah.
The latest in this short duration session of parliament were the farm bills for the much of the attention. One law that was passed was to allow what is called netting.
Yeah.
Suppose you have both kinds of positions,
yeah,
a positive position and a negative position against the same counterpart. Then you should be able to net your exposure. Suppose 100 rupees positive exposure and 80 rupees negative exposure. So I have basically 20 rupees exposure. But if I need to provide capital against this kind of exposure on 180,
yeah,
then I need much more margin money, right? Then it will not be worth my while to do this. Whereas if I net, I'm able to net this 80 against 100 and I need to make provisioning only against this 20, then it is worth my while to hedge against multiple risks.
So this would help banks, right?
This is passed.
Yeah. And this would help the banks. If Bank A had lent to developer B and had lent for 3 different projects, if Project A was...
This is not so much the bond banks lending.
Yeah.
This is basically on various derivative instruments that the investors have. Say pension fund or a mutual fund has, then it will hedge against the risk.
Yeah.
It will hedge both ways, right? Similarly, the issuer of the bond could also hedge both ways. Again, the currency going up and the currency going down, you will want to hedge. So you do net exposure that you have to provide capital against. So this is a very important step that we have now taken.
Towards the functional bond market.
This is for allowing the derivatives market to function.
Fine.
Right. So once you have a functional derivatives market, then people can hedge against the risk on the underlying bond trading. So without that, you will not actually have a bond trading. Like, you cannot set up sugar mill in a place where no sugar cane is grown, right? So you need sugar cane nearby, only then you can have a sugar farm. Similarly, unless you have the possibility of hedging against the multiple risks involved in bond trading, you will not do bond trading. So now this ecosystem of being able to hedge against multiple risks through a variety of derivatives.
Isn't this a baby step?
This is not a... We have already allowed credit default swaps.
Yeah.
We have allowed currency swaps.
Yeah.
Now we have allowed something called options on swaps. So we have been incrementally increasing the variety of things that we have.
What is missing?
Now, not many things are missing. This netting is also allowed. Now you have to create this culture of investing.
How does it begin? Who gives it a push? The government, the RBI, the macro funds? Who does this?
So the initial governments and the regulators' job is to create this ecosystem. Now, stamp duty is another important.
Yeah.
You know, the stamp duty is very high.
Yeah.
Then obviously it's not worth your while to buy these derivatives, because you registered a derivative. And bonds. So stamp duties have been brought down. They have been brought down. They have been rushed. I think they are being standardized. In any case, if it's in Maharashtra, it's fine, because you have financial markets in Mumbai, and now in the GIFT City in Ahmedabad. In GIFT City, in any case, things are far more streamlined. You know, we don't have very many currency derivatives within India. If you want to hedge against your rupee currency risk against the dollar or other currencies, you need to go to Singapore or Dubai. You have what are called the non-deliverable forwards. In the sense, you won't actually get a physical dollar if you buy a dollar 5 years from now. But you can settle it. It's a non-deliverable forward market. So that is now being allowed to happen in the GIFT City, in the financial center in Ahmedabad.
Yeah.
So in various ways, our ecosystem is being ready.
How soon will this become a reality?
I think now it's only a question of somebody coming out of the big issue.
Yeah.
So you're already allowed various kinds of risk to be effectively mitigated.
Yes.
So I think a company will have to, or an NBFC, or a, you know, HDFC, for example, can do it. HDFC has a good name. It is a reliable housing financing operation.
Yeah.
So if they were to issue bonds,
yeah,
it will have high credit rating.
Yeah.
And then you'll be able to find takers for, say, suppose they come out with a 15 or 20 year bond. There should be takers.
You know, when the REITs market began, and that is also so new. We're only in two REITs already, a third REIT is being prepared. It took almost 2 years of groundwork before that could actually hit the market, right?
Yeah.
Bond also take that long to evolve?
No,
or you think the ground is better prepared?
Some kind of bond issuance has actually taken place. The Bharat bond issuance.
Yeah.
You know, public sector companies' bonds were agglomerated into a Bharat bond.
Yeah.
And it was sold very well. So some bond issuances we are familiar with.
Yeah.
But for funding infrastructure, where, you know, the investor doesn't really have the full capacity to know the risk of the project, you want to invest in a housing finance company or some such agency which can mediate the funds to their clients. So they're in the comfort that this HDFC knows his business, housing finance company knows his business, and it knows his clients. So you wouldn't mind investing in the issue.
What is the upside for HDFC, for an NBFC like an HDFC, for a housing finance company like an HDFC to create a bond? I mean, what is the incentive for them?
You have access to large pools of capital,
which can bring down your cost of finance.
Yes. See, right now, if you look at the world,
yeah,
in Europe, your policy rates are negative.
Yeah.
In Japan, the policy rate is negative. In Sweden, it is negative, which is outside the European euro zone. In the US, it's close to zero.
Yeah.
Bank of England is close to zero.
Yeah.
It is even preparing for negative rates.
Yeah.
Now, if you are a pension fund in the US and you have promised your pensioners a certain kind of return, you need to invest in instruments that will give you that return, right? Otherwise, or you need to increase your corpus. Now, where are those returns going to come from? They had to come from places which offer you a better rate of return. Now, if India is able to offer that kind of a comfort, that if you invest in this country, you will get your money back and you will get a return on your investment, people will happily flood in. There are trillions of dollars which are looking for profitable employment in the world. It's only a question of you being able to offer the comfort that you invest in this country, you will get your money back, that your currency management will be such that your exchange rate risk is not all that high, it can be mitigated by whatever premium you pay on that for the current risk. and your accounting standards, corporate governance standards, all these are such that you will get your money back and your return on investment. People will happily come in. So this is, in my opinion, this is what the government needs to do. The government itself doesn't need to actually expand its fiscal deficit to invest in large infrastructure projects. To my mind, the government needs to give this kind of a guarantee that if you invest in a special vehicle that you are creating, you'll get your money back. The sovereign guarantee, India has never defaulted on an external loan. So if you stand that guarantee, people will happily put their money and you give them a rate of return, which is significantly higher than what they're getting. That net of all exchange rate risk, all risk, you'll get, say, it's a 3%. People will be so happy. They will come and put their money in, or 4%. It might seem like a major risk for us, but you know, going forward, I expect the productivity levels in India to go much faster than productivity levels in the rest of the world. In this case, our exchange rate risk is mitigated by this itself. And we have been able to get a grip on inflation through a better monetary policy management in the past. And we should be in a position to borrow from the rest of the world, that get the capital from the rest of the world to come and invest in our infrastructure. So today, India, Africa, etc., are full of infrastructure deficits which need to be filled.
Yeah.
While the Japan, US, Europe is full of surplus capital looking for profitable deployment, the two need to be matched. You need to bring that capital in, build the infrastructure here, so productivity here goes up, you get better income earning opportunities, and everybody is better off. Through this additional income that you generate, a certain portion of that you give to the capital that enabled you to generate that income, and everybody is happy, better off.
In fact, last week I did a show where we found that there are international funds that are creating, you know, mutual funds, equity funds kind of thing, coming into India to invest in the Indian, they find it, the stressed assets, the stressed real estate assets, an opportunity to invest last in, first out kind of thing, bring last mile funds, complete it and exit. And that seems to be a big thing from Southeast Asia, from US funds and so on. So
yeah.
clearly the international capital is looking very clear, very carefully at how well we are regulated, I think. So the trick is in how well we can manage this bonds market, right?
Yeah. See, prior to the global financial crisis, we had a very peculiar situation. Uh-huh. Countries like China, the entire petrol exporting countries, uh-huh, they were generating huge current account surpluses,
yeah,
and put in that current account surplus in US government treasury. So the savings glut in the developing world,
yeah,
the surplus capital was being sent to the American market.
Yeah.
From there, American financial agencies were raising this capital and bringing it back to the same Indian and Chinese and other countries, and by taking ownership. So you're providing your savings to these guys in the West for them to come and buy you up. And you are happy doing that. They were also happy doing that. But, you know, if you are able to use your capital here itself, you don't need to export it. Luckily, India doesn't have a current account surplus. We mostly have a current account deficit. And that is a good thing to have. You know, a current account deficit or surplus is a measure of how much you are investing domestically as compared to how much you have saved domestically. If you have a current account deficit, it means you are drawing in savings from the rest of the world to augment domestic savings to invest more than you save. That is what a current account deficit is. But somebody is financing that, right? That deficit. Somebody is willing to give you that credit. Now, if your current account deficit becomes too big, then people lose confidence that you'll be able to service this loan that they're giving you. And they will withdraw the money and then you'll collapse. So you need to have a current account deficit, but keep it at of a manageable size, which will inspire confidence in your ability to put this to good use. And then you're on welfare. So having a current account surplus is not a great thing to have. Having a modest current account deficit is the right way to manage your policy. And typically that is what India has been doing. So hopefully now that we have put this policy framework in place, more of capital will come in and we'll have a thriving bond market.
In your opinion, when will you see the first real big bond issues coming? Who's preparing for this?
I don't know if anybody who is prepared, but I wouldn't be surprised if a company like Reliance, which has appetite for large amounts of capital, comes out with a bond issue like this. Okay. Or if something like HDFC, which again can has credibility and can see the need for India to expand its real estate building as India urbanizes, and the need for long-term capital, they can issue to come out with a bond. Or SBI, or anybody can do it.
And is there a lot of groundwork that needs to be done, or groundwork is more or less finished?
The ecosystem is more or less complete. And there is only one more thing. There is this, securities transaction tax,
yeah.
STT,
yeah.
Which is a very stupid tax, perhaps, because this is like sand in the gears of machinery. Sometimes the tax has been brought down. When it was introduced, it was very, very high. Now it's relatively small. But even that small level of tax can make certain kinds of hedging of risk not worth the while. So that risk will go unhedged. So it is best to remove this tax. The government hasn't found it in their wisdom to remove this tax, but hopefully sometime they will.
Is there a deal?
Yeah. Okay. The entire finance industry has been asking them to remove this.
So with that, that's the last cog in that wheel, which should allow?
No. You need to allow people to invest in what are called junk bonds.
Yeah.
Right? So right now, nobody will invest in anything which is not rated at least AA.
Yeah.
But the biggest volume of bonds in the American market, for example, is from what are called subprime loans. That a company which doesn't have such a great reputation will still be able to issue debt, and people will invest in them because they are offering a higher rate of return. And there is always a trade-off between risk and reward. The riskier the investment, the higher the rate of return. Now, why will anybody want to invest in a very risky venture, risky bonds? Because you are not putting your entire money there. You are putting a certain proportion of your investment, say probably 5% or 10%, whereas the bulk of it you are putting in very safe instruments. So you are diversifying your portfolio and therefore diversifying your risk.
Yeah.
You can optimize the risk and reward by diversifying your asset allocation. So if that were to happen, you will find takers for. So my own favorite way this will unfold is by letting the small and medium enterprise financing industry issue bonds.
Okay.
I mean, because they are the guys who don't have access to bank funds.
Right.
A bank is very comfortable offering money to Aditya Birla Group or to Tata because the risk is very minimal. Only when there are certain other incentives involved, do you lend to Mr. Choksi or Mr. Nirav Modi. But otherwise, you are happiest lending to very well-established industrial houses, so nobody will raise a finger at you.
Yeah.
You are at a steady, reliable client, they'll service the loans, everybody's happy. But people who don't have that kind of credibility, like somebody from the small and medium universe, where will they get their money from? Right now, they're all relying on informal sources. Hardly 15% of capital they get from banks. The rest all very informal sources.
Yes.
Suppose they could issue bonds, or on their behalf an intermediary could issue bonds,
yeah.
And you could find takers with it. They will be able to offer you a higher rate of return. So a pension fund which invests in Government of India bonds, let's say 8% or 7.5%, up to certain say 30% of their portfolio, can invest 5% in 14% bonds offered by these small and medium companies. 14% is a very high rate of return for the bond investors and absolutely cheap compared to 30% small and medium company now pays for its loans. So everybody will be better off. But then you need to change your policy to allow people to invest in subprime categories of loans as well.
And is that thinking there in the financial corridors?
Well, this financial corridor certainly, but I don't know if they're in the policy making corridors as yet.
So clearly, this is a need of the hour. We need this kind of long-term capital. We need the bonds market functional. And I thought it's important enough to raise what is this bonds market and why we need it. Like you said, even in this session of parliament, netting has been allowed. Right. We've taken another step forward. Yeah. How soon we can take the remaining steps, how soon we can push it into a functional bond market where long-term capital becomes available. It also de-risks banks, right?
Right.
Today, the pressure on the banks is immense because everybody's borrowing only from the banks. So you're creating alternate funds, right?
Well, you see, banks also invest in bonds.
Yes.
Banks also generate bonds. Now, the global financial crisis was created by what are called these debt securities, which were generated by banks.
Yeah.
Banks had easy access to capital thanks to all the Chinese and petroleum exporting country surpluses being invested in the US gilt market. So interest rates were very low. So with this low cost capital, they pushed loans to various subprime borrowers, and the mortgages they originated, they securitized and converted into bonds. Then they clubbed different kinds of bonds together. And then they wrote derivatives on those bonds, sliced the derivatives and clubbed them together and created a series of instruments, all of which got a AAA rating. And it was sold around the world. Now, so banks were the ones who actually originated these bonds.
Yeah.
So they are not just people who are edged out when the bonds market thrives. They are also able to take advantage of the bond market. So if they are given a loan, mortgage for 15 years, they are able to sell that mortgage and get the liquidity once again and sell it, give a loan to somebody else. So they also gain.
So this is a missing. Seriously, from our various conversations, bonds is a missing piece in our financial landscape.
Right.
Something that we are trying to fix. Clearly, policy is being tinkered with. How soon we can push everything together? How soon we can take a position on the bonds market? Actually, means that a lot of industries, small SSIs, infrastructure, and real estate will benefit from that.
Yeah.
Thank you for explaining it out so wonderfully to all our consumers. Thank you so much.
Thank you.